Welcome to Sun City News. I'm your host, Norma Taylor. Here's what's on the agenda for this week's show. Reporter Georgia Lash went to Ridgeland to see the newest exhibit. Our Sun City News crew attended the Veterans Association Flag Day event. And later in the program, we hear about the four R's of recycling. Those stories and much more are coming up. Sun City News starts now.
From our studios in Pinckney Hall, this is Sun City News with Norma Taylor. Entertainment news with Randy Selman. Sports with Doug Wright. And the entire Sun City News team covering your community and the South Carolina Lowcountry.
Reporter Georgia Lash visited the Morris Center in Ridgeland to check out their newest exhibit, which has a connection to Pat Conroy's first book, The Water is Wide. Let's listen.
Kayla, you always have such interesting programs here, and you always invite Sun City TV to come in and check things out. Tonight's event is a book discussion, Pat Conroy's first book, The Water is Wide, which has a tie-in to Dvoski. And that happens to tie in to your newest exhibit here. I'm going to let you give us the details of that exhibit.
Thanks, Georgia. So right now we have Seasons of Dvoski. This exhibition features 20 black and white photographs. They are original prints, and these were taken by Jeannie Mutasumi Ash of Dvoski Island between 1977 and 1982. And it really captures an era of the island before it became developed, before it became what we see on Dvoski today. And just the people, and a lot of the people who are in these photographs aren't around anymore. So really just documenting that history. And what's really special about the Seasons of Dvoski is not only are you going to see the black and white photographs, I've included some images of how Dvoski looks today. So you can really see the transformation of, you know, how it's definitely changed over time.
Now that's intriguing, and the little before and after effect. Well, thank you. Now you just need to tell us, when can we come and visit Morris Center?
Definitely. So we're open right now Tuesdays through Saturdays. Tuesday through Friday, we're from 10 to 4, and then on Saturdays, we're open from 10 to 2.
Jonathan, you knew and worked with Pat Conroy, so who better to tell us, what did The Water is Wide mean to Pat Conroy?
At our Pat Conroy at 70 birthday party, which was October of 2015, Pat Conroy had a chance to talk about what book of his was his absolute favorite. And in a moment when he wasn't really even supposed to be on the stage, he said that it was The Water is Wide, because in his words, that was the magic year I became the man I meant to be. And I think about that, a 70-year-old man who had a 50-year writing career and internationally acclaimed best-selling books made into movies. There he was, sort of still self-identifying first and foremost as a teacher because of how important that year on Dvoski Island was. It was transformative for teacher and students alike. And here we are now, almost 50 years after that book came out. It'll be a 50th anniversary next year. And it still feels relevant, it still feels compelling to spend that year through those pages of that book with Pat Conroy, that amazing group of 18 kids he had on that island.
Thank you for sharing his insight. That I think is such a treasure that, you know, the Literary Center is carrying on his legacy. We're leaving you with ideas for one good read and two good places to visit to absorb some of that Lowcountry heritage.
The Sun City Veterans Association honored the history and traditions of our American flag at their annual Flag Day event. Sun City Television was there.
In 1949, June 14th was declared by Congress as a national holiday known as Flag Day. And today, our own Sun City Veterans Association carries on the tradition of honoring the Stars and Stripes. Carl, what are some of the traditions of Flag Day that we've observed here today?
Well, three of the traditions were our songs that we sang that really bring out the patriotism of people in this country, God Bless America, and of course our national anthem. That's just part of the tradition, but more importantly, learning about what our flag stands for, learning about what the different symbolisms are on the flag, stars, stripes, I think people may have heard a lot of those things for the first time, and today gave us that opportunity.
Now, does the Veterans Association continue to be available for the proper destruction of flags and for purchasing flags, perhaps?
A number of our members do collect flags, and it's, from what I understand, that as a new member of the association, Flag Day is when we collect those from the members and bring them to a destruction site, and normally that's the Bluffton Fire Department.
Well, thank you for providing us the ability to be at a service today to recognize the importance of our flag.
Well, thank you.
Court, for so many of our viewers that couldn't make it here today, would you recap what our keynote speaker, Anne-Marie Tabernack, brought up about the Flag Day ceremony?
Okay, I'd be glad to do that. The keynote speaker this morning, I thought, had a very good presentation with lots of interesting facts about the flag, its history. It dates to June 14th, 1777 by an act of Congress. And it goes all the way up through today. And she talked about the colors, very symbolic, the red, white, and blue, red representing valor, the white representing purity, and the blue representing our strength as a country.
And we appreciate the Veterans Association always reminding us. I think you all should be called, as a subtitle, the Booster Club of Patriotism here. Thank you.
Okay, you're welcome.
When we come back, Mark Davis, president of the Computer Club, stopped by the studio and spoke with reporter Chris Chase. Georgia Lash goes outside to visit the Model Railroad. And Fire Marshal Joey Rowell speaks with our news team on water usage during summer months. So stay tuned. We'll return after some messages from our sponsors. Welcome back. There are lots of changes in the Computer Club. Chris Chase sat down with the president, Mark Davis, to find out what's new. Chris?
We're so happy today to have Mark, the president of the Computer Club, with us today and tell us about the opening of the Computer Club.
Yes, on May 14th, we opened some limited hours, basically from 10 in the morning until noon, and then from 2 to 4. And it was just to open up our open room that has a majority of our equipment is in that area. So for scanning, for copying things, items of that sort. And then on the 1st of June, well, actually the 2nd, we decided that it was time to bring back our one-on-one help. And it was easier for the people scheduling to schedule a block of time. So at that point, we started blocking from 10 to noon, noon to 2, and 2 to 4. And then we set up our help sessions for Tuesdays, Thursdays, Saturdays from 10 to noon, and Wednesdays from 2 to 4.
Now, you say help sessions. What exactly do you help with?
We have different people that sign up, and they put the specialty behind their name. So if they have an area that they're more of a, I'm not going to say an expert in, but that they help in, they'll put that behind their name. So it could be Android, it could be PC, it could be Apple, it could be Mac computers, it could be Chromebook. So a person can go onto our website, and they actually can see which of our helpers works in what area.
Now, there's a lot of things in the Computer Club in that area. You mentioned printers and the computers. And who can use these?
Anyone that's a member of the club.
How many members do you have in the club now?
Currently, we're pushing 2,400.
Things. What have you done with COVID? What are the...
That's been the real interesting part. We were closed for 14 months. We really felt as if the club was too close, computers were too close to be able to do anything during the serious part of mm-hmm. COVID. As of June 1st, and once the community had kind of gone through their new mm-hmm. COVID protocols, we are now open that anyone that's vaccinated does not have to wear a mask unless they prefer to. They don't have to social distance. We ask anyone that's not vaccinated to wear a mask and to social distance.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for coming in today. Appreciate it.
Oh, you're welcome.
We'll see you again soon.
Okay. Take care and have a good day.
Sun City Television was on the right track to capture the details of the Sun City Outdoor Model Railroad.
How many neighborhood communities do you know that have their own model railroad? Well, our model railroaders, special interest group of the woodworkers, have given us just that. And here to help us learn more about it is Bert Pagano. Bert, how long has Sun City had the Outdoor Railroad?
9 years. And when it started, there was just two loops, and it was grass. That was it.
You've done a lot since then.
A little bit.
Can I just ask, what would be the most recent changes or additions you've all made?
A lot. We have a tennis court. We have a beach volleyball set. We have a barber shop. We have the general store. The list goes on. This is the G Gauge Railroad, which is Garden Railroad. We have two trains running and one trolley. All three are in different tracks. Highlight, which a lot of people like, are the sound effects for the dog park. And the softball field, which is an announcer. We have also the I Like the Cemetery, and for Halloween we have ghosts and sound effects. Okay, we also have just new addition, a soapbox derby. Even newer than that is a tennis court here, and we have over on the other side we have the beach volleyball set.
Bert, so remind us, when can our residents come over and see the track in action?
Okay, on Friday from 10 to noon, as long as it's not raining. And then holidays, we do run more times. We do post it on the website.
And I believe you put some signs up, too, that our visitors can come by.
Red Dam and the Boulevard.
Well, I want to encourage all of you to come out and see this and get on board, because there is so much to see here. Thank you very much, Bert.
You're welcome.
Water is very important and useful this time of year, as reporter Chris Chase found out from Fire Marshal Joey Rao. Let's listen.
So, Joey, what should we do with the heat? I mean, the hot weather is really coming this way.
Well, I will tell you, summer is here. And it is very, very hot. But the one benefit of the Low Country is we have so many outdoor activities here. So one thing that we do recommend in these hot, sweltering dog days that we're approaching is to stay hydrated. Water is one of the most amazing things that you can consume. We do recommend that if you have something with some electrolytes like a Gatorade or a Powerade or something along those lines, consume one of those. Don't over-consume them, because sometimes they can actually reverse what they're doing. You want to limit the intake of those, but plain old water. Now also, if you're on any type of diuretics or anything for blood pressure or whatever it may be, you may have to drink a little bit extra of this here water. Water is typically cheap, free from the tap, whatever you can do, but I will tell you, it's the best thing to basically avoid those heat emergencies. And we want our folks to know, stay hydrated, because we've got all the greatest luxuries and all the outdoor activities we can have, but stay hydrated. You don't want to have a fire truck come pick you up and give you some water.
Yeah, Joey, how would you know if you're having problems?
Now, a lot of times you'll have some onsets with some cramping, or you'll feel some just the heat exhaustion. Sometimes you may get a rash. Sometimes you may feel overly exerted. But we want to make sure that you're consuming enough. If you get to that point, a lot of times it's too late.
So Joey, now for our bodies, we need lots of water over the summer, but what about our lawns?
Well, I'll tell you what, that's a great question. Our lawns are just like our bodies. They need plenty of water also. But there's one thing that we need to keep in mind is limiting our water whenever we water in our lawns. A lot of times, Beaufort Jasper will come out with some guidelines of watering your lawns. And the reason is we don't want folks to deplete the water system down and a fire were to occur. The same water that you're watering your lawns is the same supply that we get the water to fight our fires with. So if everyone's watering their lawn at the same time, it brings those levels down, pressures and volumes go down, and if a fire were to occur, it kind of limits our capability. So if and when those restrictions come out, and because of it being hot now, and we know that folks are trying to water their lawns,
we ask them to grace us by following those guidelines to keep those folks protected. You can keep your lawn green, and it keeps your firefighters and your neighbors safe.
Still more to come on Sun City News. Randy Selman's back in the studio with entertainment events to do in our area. And what are the four R's of recycling? Doug Wright interviews the women's tennis champs from Sun City in his sports report. We'll be right back after some messages from our sponsors. Now let's head over to Randy Selman for some entertainment news.
So now that most of us have been vaccinated and the mask mandate has been lifted, it's time to venture out and enjoy what our beautiful area has to offer. Farmers markets are back in full swing. On Tuesdays, the Hilton Head Island Farmers Market at Honeyhorn, and on Thursdays, you can visit Bluffton Farmers Market on Green Street. The Hilton Head Market hopes that you will support local farmers and producers and take home fresh produce, pasture-raised chicken, range rabbit, pork, seafood, salsa, sausage, cookies, bread, she crab soup, and more. Entrance and parking are free, and the market is open from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. The Bluffton Market has a new location, now at the Martin Family Park on Green Street. They invite you to meet local farmers, chefs, and artisans. You will have the opportunity to purchase a fresh assortment of strawberries, produce, beets, potatoes, and much more. Also, you will be treated by local live entertainment and educational lectures. The market is open from noon to 5 p.m. If movies are more your thing, both Sun City and Hilton Head are featuring free movie series. Here in Sun City, you can catch a movie in Magnolia Hall twice a month. Mondays offer an evening movie and Tuesdays a matinee. On Monday, July 19th, and Tuesday, July 20th, the feature film is A Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood. This movie is rated PG and is billed as a biography drama. Tom Hanks stars as the iconic Mr. Nice Guy, Mr. Rogers. The story tells us that kindness triumphs over cynicism and is based on the true story of a real-life friendship between Fred Rogers and journalist Time Junod. This is a first-come, first-served free event. Evening movies begin at 7 p.m. and the matinees begin at 2 p.m. On Thursday evenings, Movie Nights in the Park presents Movies Under the Stars at the Shelter Cove Park at 8:30 p.m. If you have young children visiting, you might want to pack a picnic dinner, bring a beach blanket or chairs, and head over the bridge and enjoy a family-oriented movie. I'm Randy Selman, and that's your entertainment report. Remember, life is entertaining, so don't miss the show.
The Environmental Action Group challenged us to recycle, reuse, repurpose, and replace, and our neighborhoods rose to the challenge. Reporter Georgia Lash caught up with some of the 4R winners.
It is nice to see something from start to finish. Believe it or not, our first experience with learning about the 4R's Recycling Challenge was in November, sitting down with Freddie Hoffman. Today, we get to go through Sun City to find what the conclusion is and who were our winners.
Eileen Schwartz, 4R's Group Chair, awards Nick Rodotis, Hidden Cypress Alternate Rep and 4R's Challenge Captain, the certificate and banner for winning the top prize in the challenge. Nick was joined by Nancy Truman, 4R's group member, and Hidden Cypress 4R's challenge team members, Priscilla Roditis, Joan Duff, and Pat Sicati.
Georgia, I'm thrilled that Willowbrook, under the leadership of Captain Roy Powers, and you and all your neighbors won second place in the 4R's challenge. And how did you achieve that? You had a 19% increase in recycling overall between February and April. And I know that Roy and the whole team took a very low-key approach, and I wondered if you could tell us a little bit about how that worked.
And the way Roy works best is that he goes to the source. He went to all the people that he could find that did not place their bins out, and simply asked, what's the problem? Is there an issue with the, is it with the bin? Is it getting the bin out? Or is it maybe you just don't think it's worth putting the bin out? And once he helped people work through that, he found that they were willing to participate.
I'm very proud to present the Certificate of Appreciation to the Aviary Neighborhood and Captains Bev Boyle, Diana Walsh, and Ferdy Hoffman for their street fair and publicity during the challenge. Congratulations.
Thank you.
I am honored to present this Certificate of Appreciation to the Rivergrass Neighborhood and Captain Jeff Foreman. You won top special recognition in the 4Rs Neighborhood Challenge, and you had two top scores. You actually had a 27% increase in recycling with 99.5% of recycling in April. So congratulations.
Woo. Now let's head over to Doug Wright with some sports news.
Well, it seems like we've been reporting on championship efforts from our amazing senior athletes all year. And the month of May was no different. A Sun City women's tennis team of 13 players traveled to Sea Pines on Hilton Head Island to compete in the age 70 to 75 3.0 level South Carolina championship tourney played under the auspices of the USTA. This group dubbed themselves the Swingin' 70s, and they returned to campus undefeated with a championship trophy in hand. Congratulations to these athletes and their captain, Cheryl Shetter, and co-captain, Helen Mahoney. Way to go, ladies. And now, all you golfers out there, male and female, it's time to sign up for the annual Folds of Honor Golf Tournament to be held July 3rd at both Okatee and Hidden Cypress. Sign-ups end at noon on June 26th, so get behind this wonderful cause and play some golf and have some fun as well. And don't forget the Women's Softball Try-It Day on June 27th at 4:30 at the softball field. Come out and give it a try, and you may become part of the championship legacy being created by our women here in Sun City. Now let's put down those electronics, folks, and get that body in motion. Doug Wright, Sun City Sports.
Well, that's your news update for this week. Thank you for watching. We invite you to check out Sun City TV's weekly program schedule in Sensations Magazine. And now check highlights and alerts on Twitter at SunCityTVHHI. Also email us at SunCityTVHH@gmail.com. Now to see extended coverage of your favorite news segments, tune into Extra. Check the current Sensations magazine for daily times. Make sure you tune in next week to find out all the news that's happening in our community. And in the meantime, I hope your week is full of only good news. For Sun City News, I'm Norma Taylor.